Morning, everyone. We're going to go ahead and start. I'm Andy Raby. If you need to ask a question during the webinar, during the meeting, please write in the question section. If you are going to be speaking remotely by telephone, please make sure you put in your access code and your PIN, and that way I'll be able to unmute you. And this meeting is being recorded. And off to Wayne Black.
Good morning, everybody. Appreciate everybody being on the call today on the webinar. We've got a lot to cover. There's a couple things we want to cover here, put in the agenda first, before we get down to a brief overview on House Bill 630. First of all, it is my pleasure to introduce one of our newest members of our team here at the Division of Social Services at DHHS, and he is Richard Staginga. Richard is our new Deputy Director for Business Operations at the Division of Social Services, started September 1, and I'm really glad to have Richard on board. He's hit the ground running. I'm going to ask Richard. Richard's got a background in a couple of county departments of social services and in business operations, and so I want to introduce Richard and have Richard share a little bit about his background.
Good morning, everybody. Haven't been on the other side of this call for multiple years. I'm going to make this really quick. So Richard Staginga, my responsibility area is business operations. So that's finance, accounting, budget, contracts, performance management, et cetera. 25 years in local government. I have worked in two county departments of social services, Alamance and Durham County, and looking forward to seeing the state side of operations.
Thank you, Richard. One quick note I want to make here on the regard to our staffing, our leadership and positions and so forth, is we will be getting out to directors soon an organizational chart. We want to provide information as soon as everything gets finalized in terms of our persons in leadership and the different positions and who to contact and their contact information. So that's still on our list. It's on a to-do list to get to you. The second thing I wanted to talk about briefly is a reminder that this is actually tomorrow, September 28th, from 10 a.m. to 12 noon. Information went out before about this, and this is going to be another webinar, technical assistance, and this is in regard to the MOA with the Mexican consulate. That was sent out to counties probably about a month or so ago. So this is going to include the presentation from the Consulate General of Mexico here, who's stationed here in Raleigh, will be part of that. And I'm going to ask Carlotta Dixon, who's coordinating this, to get the invite information, and we're going to route that out again through Attorney's Ransom through the Directors Association today. So to make sure you've got that information for the webinar tomorrow. And the other thing we want to do quickly here at the beginning of the meeting is we have a presentation in regard to some important matters by Sam Gibbs. Sam is our Deputy Secretary for Technology and Operations with the Department of Health and Human Services. And I think Sam is with us on the phone today.
Yes.
Yes, I am, Wayne.
Okay. We hear you loud and clear.
Okay, thanks very much, Wayne, and I appreciate the opportunity to get a chance to speak with you all this morning. One quick message I want to leave with you is I think most of us are aware of the current security issues around the Equifax data breach. You know, that affected hundreds of a million folks, including myself. And so I'd like to just bring to your attention a few things that I've noticed here in the last few months that have happened countywide. In regards to county networks being affected with viruses or malware or ransomware, since April, we've been aware of three counties that have had such instances. In fact, one county has had a total network infection, and they have had to shut down their network for a while to do that. So I'd like to just remind everybody and tell everybody this is a serious issue. It's not if you're going to be affected by one of these, it's when. And so, you know, a couple of things is to take all the precautions with your IT staffs to make sure that you have the latest virus protections. It would be also good to have some type of a third-party monitoring system in place. And then secondly, the notification requirements. DHHS is required to notify our federal partners within 24 hours of any type of incident via MOUs between the counties and the state. You all are also required to notify us within 24 hours of these things. And it does a couple of things. The state has pretty robust IT department here, and we have resources available to help you work through these particular problems like we have done with counties in the past. So I just want to make this aware of for all of you, and to make sure that, A, you do as best you can to protect yourselves for your networks, and two, to make sure you notify us, and then you can get the full weight of the state of North Carolina to help you work through your problems. So thank you very much. We'll be communicating this up through your county commissioners and city managers as well, but I wanted you to get a firsthand knowledge from us directly that this is a serious issue and that we need to make plans for and to continue to monitor it. And again, we're here to help. Thanks, Wayne.
Thank you, Sam. Appreciate that important information, and certainly a reminder to the counties that this is something we are seeing more and more of, it seems like, on a county level, but also on a national level. And we just need to be attuned to that. I know everybody's working with their team in the county to protect information, but certainly, again, to reiterate, if you have an incident, please don't hesitate to notify us, and certainly within 24 hours. And as Sam said, we're here to help. Good. I want to talk a little bit about House Bill 630. And this is going to be a regular update on the agenda going forward. Part two, the RFP process there. Again, the key thing there is the RFP will be released Friday, September 29th, this week. And then once it's out there, then we'll you'll see more detail and the information that's in it. And we're looking to get those applications in from interested third-party organizations, looking ahead to, the whole process of selection. So that's the key step there is that through the work of the Office of State Budget Management, and certainly Michael Beckett's our Assistant Secretary and a team of folks, including our contracts and division folks, department folks here with us, have also supported the effort from OSBM to meet the deadline and get that RFP out before the deadline of September the 30th. The second thing is part three, local DSS written agreements. Again, the work is being done here to across our programs to identify and categorize specific performance measures around federal requirements or state requirements for program performance in all the different areas of social services that are administered by county DSSs, with the idea that the requirement in the legislation is for a contract with counties effective July 1, 2018. So we're working on that. I'm aware the Directors Association has a process as well to provide information and recommendations in terms of some of those performance metrics. Work on that will be continuing pretty much hard and heavy for the next 2 or 3 months as well. The next one, it really should be part six, VI. This is the driver's license pilot, which is one of those parts of the legislation, House Bill 630, more specific to child welfare. And we've got a great work group on this. And this does include representatives, I believe, from 4 county departments of social services, links coordinators, and folks like that. We've got folks from SESO. We've got foster youth. We've got foster parents. Family partner and others that have engaged with our folks in our division to put together a plan. We had a meeting yesterday. I think there's actually been 3 meetings of this work group, and a 4th one is planned for this week. So working through the processes, the procedures, the policies to govern this. As you know, the legislation appropriates $75,000. It's non-recurring for each year of the biennium to do a pilot. The intent of this, I think, is to try to be proactive in coming up with not just the funds to help support the process in conjunction with your links money, but also to identify barriers, identify solutions. And again, we're all part of trying to help young people if they want to be successful, and we want them to be, to get access to a car, to a driver's license, because in this world, it's pretty doggone important. And so continue to work on that. I expect we'll probably be something out within probably the next month or month and a half. You'll be seeing that. So again, good work taking place there. And I think that's all I have in regard to House Bill 630. So next on the agenda, it's my pleasure to introduce Melissa Askew, who is with the North Carolina Department of Agriculture and Consumer Services, and worked with our folks with economic service on this and felt like it was important to have a presentation on the Commodity Supplemental Food Program. Melissa.
Good morning. I would first off thank you for allowing us the opportunity to come out and speak on this important household program that has really hit the door running this past year. First off, I am the household program administrator for all of the food programs through the Department of Agriculture Food Distribution. We manage and operate the TFAP SKP, which is Soup Kitchen, as well as our Commodity Supplemental Food Program for Senior Citizens, as we call it, CSFP. As of July 1 of last year, we were only in one county within the state of North Carolina that we were offering the Commodity Supplemental Food package to seniors. And we are excited to say, as of today, we're in 23 counties in the state of North Carolina. We were allowed the opportunity to submit a request for additional caseloads. And our caseloads are issued to us by the federal government. It's not something that we get to decide. As a state agency, we have to be allotted the caseload, which is basically a participant. So for every caseload equals one individual. We had started off around 1,267, and today we're serving 5,807 senior citizens in the state of North Carolina. We are in 23 counties, and we're operated through three food banks of North Carolina, and then we have one smaller agency known as Beacon of Hope up in Madison County in our western region. Currently, we are asking all of our food banks through North Carolina to submit a request if they are interested in opening this program up to the counties that they serve. We've asked them to submit a request of the number of participants that they feel like that they could serve by the end of October. And then we will submit this request to USDA in November. And this all will be based on Trump administration and funding. We're in high hopes that the funding will continue. I do know that it has been requested to have an increase in the budget for the CSFP for the seniors programs. So we're just crossing our fingers and hoping for good things. So who do we serve? We actually serve seniors that are age 60 and older. As long as they're 60 and older and they meet our income guidelines, we are on a 130% income poverty guideline, and this is mandated by the federal government. Our TFAP program that we issue to households through the food banks are on a 200% poverty income guideline level, so it is a little bit of a difference. The senior citizen must reside in a county that is being served, so they have to live in one of the current 23 counties that we're offering the CSFP program to. And if they have spouses, both the spouse and the husband and the wife can get a package apiece. So it's not one package per home, it's per senior citizen. So they would actually have their own separate application, and they would have, so the food bank would have two applications on the husband and one on the wife, so that they'll have their own identification number and they'll get their own package. So I want to talk just a little bit briefly about what the CSFP package looks like. This is a mandated package. It is based on a nutritional value, and something for us to remember is this is a supplemental nutrition package. You can go ahead, let's move to the next slide, because that's just our income guidelines that everybody can look at later. So our USDA CSFP package, this is based on nutritional value to help the senior citizens, and every senior will get what you see here on the screen. Does everybody get a copy of this so they can see this? Mm-hmm. All right. So every senior citizen will always get two boxes of cereal. The cereal can be anything from oatmeal, we have what we call a farina, which is like a cream of wheat. And then we also have the dry cereals, like your Rice Krispies and your Corn Flakes and Cheerios. Our bottles of juice, they're actually 64-ounce bottles of juice that the senior citizens will receive, and they are can be a combination of orange juice, grape juice, apple juice, cran apple, so it's a variety. They don't have to get the same thing all the time. The UHT milk is basically a shelf-stable liquid milk. It's a 1% milk, and they'll get two cartons of that. And then every other month, we have a 3-pound bag of dry milk that the seniors can get that they can use in recipes or however they would like in their cooking. And then they get a 2-pound block of cheese. We have a variety of different kinds of meats. So they either get a large can or two smaller cans of like the canned chicken, tuna, salmon. We have beef stew. We have canned beef as well. Then we can, they always will get either a jar of peanut butter or a bag of dry beans. And that could be like the kidney beans or Great Northern beans. And then we have pasta. We issue them either macaroni, spaghetti, or rice. So they will always get one of those three items, and then they'll have four cans of vegetables and two fruits. And the vegetables and fruits are basically what you see in your grocery stores that are offered there. And we always try to have a package that's a variety. So every month they won't get the same kind of vegetables and fruits, and it kind of just varies. And I will say that all of these items that they get in their package to go along with the nutritional value is low sodium, and the USDA is currently, we have a review team for the CSFP package this year, and hopefully maybe within the next year and a half, if it's approved, the package may change. They are investigating every item that we issue the seniors because we're trying to meet that need, meet the high blood pressure needs, meet the diabetic needs, because a lot of the fruit juices can be high in sugar, and it might not necessarily be healthy for all seniors to be able to receive. So the USDA, it's a lot of information and research that's going on the back end that people don't get to see, that they are trying to address the nutritional value. And we were able to go to a CSFP conference in New Orleans this year, and we had a doctor to come out and actually speak on the importance of our commodity supplemental food program and what that means for seniors. Because as you know, in the Department of Social Services, we see it every day, the need where seniors are trying to battle and balance paying their light bills versus buying food and then their medications. And it all goes hand in hand. They all need to have their electricity and their heat. They all need their medicines as well as their nutrition. Because when their nutrition starts to fail, then their health fails, and that just causes a greater expense for them. So this is where we are in the state of North Carolina. Our goal is to hopefully increase to additional counties effective January, hopefully, if all the plans go through with the administration. And we just appreciate any efforts that your agencies may be able to allow us. Just encourage your caseworkers to let the seniors know about the programs that are being offered in the counties that is currently being served. I have provided Connie Dixon with a list of the agencies that are currently distributing CSFP along with their contact information, and she can send this information out to you all. And so anybody within your agency, if they need to reach out to the food bank that is in charge of doing this distribution, we have their contact name and number, and they can let you know where the applications are being taken. And I can say that currently we are at full caseload. As of last Thursday, we have met our full caseload of 5,807. So any additional senior citizens that apply for the program will be on a wait list, and that wait list will be included in the number that we are going to be asking for additional caseload, hopefully for the 2018 year. So thank you.
Great.
Do we have any questions?
No questions from online.
Okay. And they can always email me. My contact information is on the last slide, and if they think of something later and they want to email me, they're more than welcome to.
Melissa, I'm assuming, is this what you're referring to?
Yes, that is what I'm referring to.
So the list that Melissa referred to, we'll send that to Andy to include in the PowerPoint.
We post all the presentations and any information at least by 2 days after the meeting. So
okay,
along with the recording of the webinar.
And I think also, Melissa, it's so important in terms of what you're talking about here, in terms of it's food that's designed and targeted to those seniors that may have chronic conditions. And this is a priority of our department. One of our key core mission or goals is around impacting in a positive way the social, what we call the social determinants of health.
Mm-hmm.
Those things that that do impact health in a preventive way or could impact health way in a negative way, in terms of those things in life, you know, around food and housing and other kinds of things as well. So I think it's very appropriate to have this conversation because the County Department of Social Services, we do serve a large population. We've always, I think, been looking to do outreach with those seniors who typically have been underrepresented in the food nutrition caseload. And again, just like you say, folks that choose between food or medicine or heating their house and those kinds of things are critically important. So we appreciate it.
Thank you so much.
All right.
I appreciate your time.
Okay. Have a good one. And segueing really kind of from that, I'm going to ask David Locklear, if he would, to share a little bit about the project that we are rolling out with BDT, Benefits Data Trust, reaching out to, again, Medicaid recipients 60 and over to connect him to participation in the Food Nutrition Services Program.
Thank you, Wayne. And Melissa, thank you again for sharing the information. And I think today seems to be we're focusing on our senior population in regards to food nutrition services. So I just want to continue a little bit along that vein. As many of you know, with the Benefit Data Trust, that we've been working with them for several months, and now we're beginning to get some results from them. So currently, we BDT is working with 36 counties, and meaning that applications, letters have been sent to those to citizens in those 36 counties that meet our target population, which is individuals 60 and older, and we are beginning to receive applications back from those individuals. So as of September 20th, BDT has received 585 applications for seniors in those 36 counties, and of those 585 applications, 324 of those applications have been submitted to the appropriate county. Now, one of the questions that has come up as regarding the number of expedited applications that the counties are receiving, along with the number of applications they're receiving that do not contain the documentation. Because as you recall, when we began our initial conversations around the BDT project, is that that BDT offers assistance for the household to help them collect the information. And the initial plan is that BDT would collect the information from the individual, the documentation, and then the application would be submitted through EPASS along with the verifications. So the anticipation was that once you got the application, it would be ready to process. So we are not seeing as many of those come in that are ready for you to process. And there's a reason, and one of those reasons would be that we have to give that household the opportunity. BDT offers them assistance in collecting their information. However, that individual can decline if they want assistance or if they want to work directly with the local DSS. And I think when you look at this population, you know, our seniors, 60 and older, they are somewhat more independent and they want to do things a little bit more on their own. And that is definitely the case that BDT believes that they are encountering with the individuals. They're getting a lot of feedback from individuals that say things like, oh, I know DSS, I've been there. You know, they go there for Medicaid, they go there for other reasons. So they feel like they have a really good relationship with the county DSS office. So the response typically is back to BDT representative that my preference is that I work directly with the county. So we definitely want to give them that option. So if you're seeing a lot of applications without documentation, that's one, you know, one of the reasons why you're seeing those. The other, in regards to the expedite, you know, if an individual comes in and they are expedited, then those applications we must push through the county because, you know, we have to provide benefits to the household within the 7 days that they're, or ensure that the household has received their benefits within the 7 days if they're eligible. So that's kind of give you a little feedback as to why you may be getting a lot of applications. So we are very excited about the number of applications that are coming in. because I think it ties back to Melissa's conversation, is that these are individuals that are not receiving benefits, that are receiving, they may or may not be receiving Medicaid. These are not receiving Medicaid, right?
They get Medicaid.
Yeah, these are Medicaid. But again, you still have folks that are having to make those decisions between purchasing food or paying an electric bill or a water bill or whatever the case may be. And, you know, oftentimes these folks may only qualify for a lower benefit, you know, even if it's the minimum allotment, which is the $16, you know, I think it's very incumbent upon us to help in the counties to help folks understand there's a benefit, even if it's only $16. You know, you can buy, you know, a loaf of bread, a gallon of milk, you know, a couple cans of fruit or vegetables. So we have to help them see the benefit in that $16 allotment. You know, oftentimes we tell folks that, you know, if you're getting that $16, you know, you can save that up and maybe use that money for Thanksgiving or for Christmas, because those benefits are good for 365 days. So that's kind of where we are at the current moment with the 36 counties. Now, I believe, and I have to ask Wayne, I didn't get a chance to ask him this morning. I believe we have sent out notification on yesterday, I believe, or this week.
From Connie Dixon, I think, to about 24 counties, maybe.
26 counties. So the next round of counties, there's 26 counties, and the letters for those 26 counties will begin going out to the residents in those counties on October the 4th. So you can anticipate, once they send the letters out to the household, typically it's about a 2 to 3 week time frame when BDT begins to get those calls. And so you're looking at about 30 days where you potentially would see applications coming in for the additional 26 counties. And then the final phase of the process will be for the remainder 38 counties, and we will begin to send out notifications for those 38 counties on October the 18th. So you can anticipate potentially applications starting to come in a couple of weeks after that October the 18th date. Once we will be sending out again an email, will most likely come from Connie Dixon, who is our coordinator for this project, that will notify the county directors if you're in that additional list. But if you're in the current 36, you received an email for the 26 this week, you can anticipate you're gonna be in the next group of the 38 counties. So, question?
One question that came in: do you have a breakdown by county as to how many applications each county has received?
I do, and what I'll do is I think I have it. I've got it with me, yes. We can send it to Andy, and we can attach it to the presentation today. I will say, just, you know, and I'm not going to go through the, I'm not going to take time to go through the list. I just don't have time to do that. But I will say it's in regards to the county that we are seeing the most response is Guilford County, followed by Mecklenburg. So thus far through the September 20th date, Guilford has received 54 applications, and then at Mecklenburg following up with them at 49. I thought it very interesting that that Wake, I would have anticipated Wake would have been may have been up there next to Guilford. Wake has received 29 of those applications. So those are the top three, Guilford, Mecklenburg, and Wake, in regards to the receipt of applications. You know, many of these folks are deciding they're not interested. They don't want to provide their information. And one of the things, and I think I mentioned this in another meeting prior to this, and I'll close with this, is that we have also received reports from BDT that some of the individuals that they are contacting are saying to them that they were told by the county DSS office that this was a scam. So I want to make sure that every county director, it is imperative that all staff within your agency understand this is a real project, and these are real letters that are going out. They're going out under DSS. They're going out under Wayne's signature. BDT is acting as an agent for the Department of Health and Human Services. So from your front desk staff, your clerical staff, folks that answer the phones, call centers, it's imperative that everybody understands this project so that if they are getting calls from citizens within your county, they can validate that, yes, this is a real project. This is supported by the department and encouraging folks to participate in that program. Any other questions?
No other questions.
All right.
Thank you, Dave.
All right. Thank you.
The one thing I would add to that, I think, is a testimony to the positive customer service at your County Department of Social Services. If these folks are saying to BDT that they would rather deal with directly the staff of the County Department of Social Services, it would seem to indicate to me that they've had a positive experience. And if that's the case, that's a good thing. Okay. All right. Next up, we're going to have some information about the Medicaid program, report card, foster care policy. Carolyn McClanahan, I believe, is on the call.
Hello. Can you hear me?
Sure can.
Okay. Just a couple of things. We did post the August report card last Wednesday on the 20th. There was continued improvement showing on that report card. 81 counties passed. I am looking at the report card. There are weekly report cards for the current month that are also available in that same area so that you can see how you're doing during the month. And it looks like that looks a little bit better even. Beginning with in October, with the September report card, we're just going to be on our regular monthly schedule then. So normally the report cards are run on the fifth work night of the month, and then they're posted within the next couple of days. There was an issue reported a couple of weeks ago that some directors were not able to see report cards and things again, even though we had addressed that issue once. And so there was something that was done in the release last weekend that corrected that. And I did verify that with Trish Baker and a couple of directors that they now did have access to see those reports. So if there are any other issues, just let me know. But we believe that that's fixed now. The other thing about the foster care and adoption assistance programs moved over to P7 during the release. One of the things about this, it's been a long time coming, is that we do have to apply the MAGI rules for the foster care that are non-4E and adoption that are non-4E. And caseworkers have had to do that and then key forced eligibility into P26. And as you're all aware, that of course leads to some errors and people look at how many forced cases we have. So now that evaluation process will be done correctly over in P7. The correct evidence needs to be entered just like it would have been on the other side. So if they are 4E, there's a job aid that shows, you know, how to check the funding source and those kind of things. So nothing has really changed as far as the policy. 4E children are still automatically eligible. A special needs adoption child, as we've had to do since healthcare reform began, we have to look at them under the MAGI rules first, and then if they're not eligible there, then we apply the special needs adoption rules. So all of that is in sort of one side of the house now, which makes that evaluation process a little easier, and workers don't have to keep forced into P26 for those foster care cases. Policy, we are working on that. It's going to come out November 1st, and I've got a couple other policy changes just to tell you we're working on for November to update that and to get the policy that a lot of the current policy is an administrative letter or two, and so we're going to incorporate that in the policy so it'll all be in one place. And we anticipate that coming out by November 1st. Couple other policy pieces that we have that we're working on, the application sections, just reorganizing and updating the application sections. The NEMT, non-emergency medical transportation, that has been sent to the Economic Benefits Committee, and we'll be getting some comments from them. We also will be updating and moving the disability sections. So the policy on those individuals who are required to have disability determined as part of the application process. So those are the things we're looking at as far as November 1st.
So yeah. Carolyn, this point, just to clarify on your foster care, adoption, Medicaid policy. So is there any, with the applying the Magi and what you're talking about, is there any risk of children not being covered by Medicaid that otherwise have been?
Well, I mean, that's the policy that's been in place since health care reform started.
Right.
As far as applying the Magi rules, of course, they're not living with their parents, so you wouldn't be counting parents' income even under Magi rules or anything like that. So it's still sort of business as usual.
Okay. We have a question.
We do have a question. We had actually two questions. We can only access the weekly report card when we enter NCFAS through Internet Explorer, not through Google Chrome. Is that being worked on? Do you know that?
I don't know. May have to ask NCFAS if there's something we can do about that, but that is correct. And I think it's NCFAS and even a couple other things. If you don't see something that you think you should, you just need to, you may be in Explorer and you might have to use Chrome, or you might be in Chrome, you might have to use Explorer, but I can find out if there's a way to work on that.
Great.
I'll take that back as an issue. Mm-hmm.
I know that NCFAS is on the line, and maybe they can answer that when we get down to them.
Okay.
Also, we've had transportation agencies in which they are saying they can no longer transport stretcher-bound patients due to having not been paid through MA. Have you heard anything about this, and how should the counties handle this?
Well, there's a couple of things, and I do need to know if you can tell me the company, because you know, some of the stretcher bound is that they also need some sort of medical support while they're in transit. Okay. And so that is a normal Medicaid ambulance claim that, you know, they've been filing for years, and not non-emergency medical transportation. Now, if it were only the transportation, which happens very, very rarely, that the county has to arrange with an ambulance or a van that has stretcher just to transport, no medical support, then that's between you and them, and you do it just like a normal non-emergency medical transportation. But I believe they're probably talking about the one where it's non-emergency medically necessary. And so I was on a call about one company that had some issues with that. But if you can ask the person to send me the information, then I'll send it where it needs to go at DMA.
Yeah, this person said they were only going to the doctor that time.
Right, but
the doctor.
So did the, and again, I need the county to contact me because there's going to be some questions. Because even some people who have to, even if they're just being transported to the doctor, because of their medical conditions, sometimes they have to have oxygen administered during the trip, or they have to have their vitals monitored because they're fragile. That still is a regular ambulance claim and not non-emergency transportation, because again, if they're going to the doctor, they don't need medical support and the county arranged it, then the county would be uploading that claim into NCTRAX for the vendor to file as a non-emergency claim. So I just need a little more information.
Right. What we'll do is we'll take that one offline, Carolyn. We've got the information on the county. We'll just connect that directly to you and you can follow up with them.
Yeah, that would be great.
Right. Any other questions?
No other questions.
Okay, Carolyn, thank you.
Thanks.
Next item on the agenda, I want to give an update on organizational structure as it pertains to the operational support team. The decision has been made at the department that, and this is already in effect, in regard to the, as everyone knows, we had taken the operational support team, which is still intact, and we had created what we call the Economic and Family Services Group, which is headed by Regina Bell and includes our OST members with knowledge and expertise in the areas of food nutrition services, work first, energy programs. And then the second group is Medicaid, headed by Barbara Daniels with staff who have expertise in the Medicaid and health choice. And Regina stationed here at our office at Division Social Services, and Barbara located over at RTP, and also co-located with Carol McClanahan's group and eligibility. The previously they had reported, they'd been in different places, they'd reported originally to the deputy secretary when it was established, they reported to me for a while, they reported to Michael Beckett, the assistant secretary, and keeping with the reorganizational plan, Regina Bell now reports to David Locklear, who's our deputy director for Economic and Family Services, and Barbara Daniels will report to Carol McClanahan at DMA. What we're really working to do, and I think this is partly due to feedback we've gotten from counties, our goal is really to more closely connect the OST folks with the program and the policy people and the knowledge of policy. We also want to have a connection between the policy and the technology. We had a conversation about this yesterday at a meeting that from your perspective, we know that policy is good, but if you don't have the technology piece with it in terms of the intersection of the person with the policy, with the technology, then things don't work well. So that is our goal, to try to be more effective. The other thing, certainly from our perspective, Carolyn talked about the report cards and some of the data we have there on performance in Medicaid. Same thing with food nutrition. For example, we have our M&E reviews with counties. We have our QC monitoring of pulling cases on a random sample. We have report cards on timeliness of apps. The timeliness report card, I believe, David, for recertifications is going to be validated and will be coming out, I believe, in October. And so our OST will work closely with David and his team. It will be one team, all right? They'll work together to support counties based on the data available to us or based on your needs as we identify or you identify. Key thing there is targeting to where the needs are. I think we'll learn a lot from the monitoring and process around training. So I think this also feeds into that. So anyway, all of this is going to be connected, I think, much more closely, and we hope that this would, you know, one of the things we've heard, I think, is there's sometimes a disconnect from different, you know, from program or from the policy or from NCFAST. We want to make sure that that is extremely seamless and that there's not a disconnect. So you'll be learning more about that, of course, working together still on things like training, consultation, technical assistance, cluster meetings, again, being targeted, you know, like we did the last time, I believe, targeting towards Medicaid, targeted towards economic programs, and having everybody in the room. Okay. Questions?
No questions.
We're going to move on.
Wait, I'm sorry. Before you move on, can you just mention real briefly, I think we talked a little bit yesterday about our lean.
Thank you. Yes. Yeah. So, you know, as all things happen, we have to look at our resources. And that makes me think of another thing I want to say. But anyway, we have to look at our resources and we have to look at our priorities. And I think we've done a number, I think probably up to around 25 or so lean events with counties. We believe that our OST folks have knowledge of the lean process. They've been through the process, most of them been certified. And so we believe that they can also help your county in looking at your workflow and your processes and how things are done with the knowledge of lessons learned from other counties on maybe best practices, although every county is different. So what we're looking at right now is we're probably not in a position until we get in a better place in terms of performance, particularly in Medicaid as well as in FNS and Work First, around performance and timeliness and payment accuracy and quality. And in FNS, we're looking at active error rate and we're looking at CAPER as well. So that's going to be our priority, I think, in terms of training needs. So we're probably going to postpone any kind of lean events that we're going to be having to take place with counties at this point in time. We'll look at seeing if we can get back to that later. David, anything else on that?
Thank you.
That's it. All right, we're going to move on. Child Support Services, Judy McCarn.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I hope everybody's great on this Wednesday morning. So I'll give you a few updates from child support. First thing that's not on your agenda, come October, we'll start paying incentives. So I wanted to quickly mention that. I want to thank everybody for sending in their incentive plans this year. So we have almost all of them, so I appreciate everybody's assistance with that. But as part of receiving your incentives, we must have those incentive plans. So I quickly wanted to mention that. The other piece that we are working on is getting ready for the IRS Office of Safeguard visit. They will be here on November the 14th through the 16th. So over the next 2 months, lots of changes will be occurring with ACTS, XPTR, those kinds of things. One piece I did want to mention that we will implement October the 9th, and we'll be sending out notification regarding this, is that part of the security that the IRS requires us is that if your computer or ACTS sits idle for 30 minutes, it will automatically terminate. It'll go back to the banner screen, and then you're going to have to re-log in with all your passwords. So just keep that in mind when you're in court and those kinds of things. But we will be sending out information on how that will work in the next week or so. But we hope to have all that implemented October the 9th. Quickly mention the multi-factor authentication piece. We will implement that to state employees only in October. We'll work out any issues with that. We'll do a demo for the IRS when they're here in November. If it's acceptable from the IRS, we will do a rollout plan for the counties towards the end of January, February, over probably 6 months. But wanted to give you an update on that. We will have a document change. This is a letter, a notice that we send to the non-custodial parent. We're going to be removing a tax source from that document. So we have that, hopefully have that in place at the end of October. The other piece is XPTR. We'll have to bring that behind the firewall. That will be coming at the end of October. So everybody's going to be hearing more about that. And that is only for child support, not any other program, but just child support. So we'll be having to track the child support IP addresses to make sure all that is secure. And that's all part of the IRS requirements. So when the IRS is here in November, they're going to be visiting two counties. So the two awesome counties that were chosen was Durham and Warren County. So I appreciate their willingness to work with us on that. So the rest of you can have a sigh of relief on that visit. But we will be giving you the agenda once we have all that set. We have a generic agenda that the IRS has sent us. We should be having an entrance conference with them tomorrow, and we'll know a little bit more tomorrow on that visit, but it'll be about 2 hours in your office. They'll talk with staff, look at cases, check filing cabinets, and we'll work with those two counties and make sure that they're very prepared. The other piece I wanted to quickly mention is a huge project that we're working on, and that is our online child support application. As you're aware, we changed the application to get better data for our data reliability audit. And we're taking that application and making it online. So that will be effective in January. So we're very excited about that. And stay tuned as we build that. You'll see a whole revamp of our e-child support and what users will be able to see in the child support and be able to log on for our online child support application. Any questions?
One question mm-hmm. came through. We've been told, and somebody just did another one. Hold on 1 second.
Okay.
We've been told based on the 4EFC adoption cases in P7, Carolyn just referred to, we'll have to close and reopen all FC child support cases and child support. Is that true?
I've been hearing a little bit about that. We are having some trouble with those referrals that on the foster care cases, we're having to close those and reopen that. because of the data that we're receiving. Our system folks are working on that process and seeing an NC FAST to see if they're, we cannot correct it, but just got one email on that this morning.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Something we need to follow up on.
That's something that's been, yeah.
That's it.
Okay. All right.
Thank you.
Have a good day.
All right. We're going to move on to talk about some things with the child care subsidy services. Elizabeth Everett.
Good morning. Hope everyone's doing well. All right. So first off, I wanted just to make sure that everyone has had a chance to review the Dare County Director letter that we went out earlier this week about the annual re-enrollment process for our child care providers. So this is not a new process by any means, but it is the first time that providers are going to be going through the re-enrollment process through the provider portal. So we definitely are asking for each county to help us as we reach out to providers. They have to have this done before December 31st of this year, or the NC FAST will not allow them to get paid through NC FAST anymore. So it's extremely important. So just wanted to make sure that that was on the radar and distribute that as needed. There will be a message in the portal to providers beginning October 1st reminding or notifying them that they need to go through the re-enrollment process. And then as we go through getting into December, actions or alerts will come to provider managers and workers within the system to make them aware of any providers that have not re-enrolled. So just wanted to bring that, as that's definitely something that's very important right now and a new process. And County Champions probably saw the email. We did send an email through the NC FAST email list to the providers last week. So they heard about it already and they can go ahead and enroll or re-enroll now. They don't have to wait. Okay. I also wanted to talk about our new unit within subsidy. I've talked briefly about it in the past, but wanted to give a little bit more detail today as the unit is getting, they've been on board since June and they're really getting more and more organized and starting to do some visits along with regulatory. So just wanted to give you some of the housing wise behind this unit. And the manager for this unit is Kim Miller, but unfortunately she was not available to come and talk to you guys this morning. So I am talking to you about this on her behalf. So of course, if there's any questions that I'm not able to answer, I'll definitely take back to her. So it is provider compliance and it's made up of four consultants. They are divided into regions. Very similar to our, or actually exactly the same as our program compliance consultants. So there's a East, West, East Central, and West Central. So they cover about 25 counties each. And like I said, they're already on board and they're beginning to work with regulatory on some visits and are looking to probably start making visits for solely this purpose, probably sometime in October. We definitely have to get communications out, which I'll cover a little bit as well. Some additional members of this unit that will be coming on board in coming months, there will be a lead worker as well as an auditor. These are new positions that haven't yet been filled, so we're still going through the process with HR. Just to give you a little bit of background as to why this came about, or one of the reasons why this came about. So as you're probably aware, the Child Care and Development Fund program was the final rules were published September 30th of 2016. And with those final rules, an entirely new section was added to its 98.68. And that section requires that lead agencies, and of course, we're talking about the CCDF, the federal, so when they talk about lead agencies, for us, we're talking about the division. The final rule requires lead agencies to have effective procedures and practices that ensure integrity and accountability in the CCDF program. A strong commitment to program integrity is required, as described in the preamble. And to quote the preamble, it states that ACF expects lead agencies to have rigorous processes in place to detect fraud and improper payments. The final rule also requires lead agencies to ensure that providers are trained and knowledgeable about program rules as a part of ensuring integrity. So that gives you a little bit of background from federal expectations as to why one of the reasons why this unit has come about. The overall purpose is going to be to monitor child care providers who are receiving subsidized child care assistance payments. They'll be monitored for compliance with the program requirements, and this unit will also work collaboratively with the division's regulatory services, in addition to DHHS's Office of the Internal Auditor and other DHHS programs related to noncompliance, overpayments, and fraudulent misrepresentation. A written message will be coming to child care providers. Again, that will go through that NCFAS provider listserv, outlining information about this unit and what activities they will be performing, as well as a message will be sent out to counties, as well as local partnerships and the CCRNR agencies to assist them with preparing child care providers for this new unit. Let's see. So they'll work by completing visits to child care providers to gather and assess accuracy of attendance records across different types of attendance records that are available. They'll also be looking at issuance of receipts for parent fees during those visits. And there'll be we're pulling random samples of providers that'll be monitored, because again, with four consultants and over 4,000 providers enrolled in the subsidized child care assistance program, they're not going to be able to see every provider each year. So it's going to come out to about 100 visits per consultant each year. So a total of about 400 that'll be caught up in this random sample. Our initial focus is going to be on child care centers. And then there will be targeted visits or targeted monitoring that will come in response to complaints that might be received, or if there are concerns that are found through the regulatory consultants, because of course all the licensed providers get at least one regulatory visit a year, or it could be concerns that come through the work of the Office of the Internal Auditor, or any red flags that come from the metrics developed by the Office of the Internal Auditor. So, and also there could be targeted visits in conjunction with program monitoring at the local purchasing agencies, which of course will continue to be done by the program compliance consultants. So depending on the type of visit, it could be announced or it could be unannounced. There will be a brief monitoring checklist that the consultant will complete on site with the provider, and they will collect at least the previous month's attendance documents. Depending on how that goes, they may need to collect three or more months, depending on the type of visit and the concerns that might arise. And then the attendance records, the comparisons are going to be made between potentially several different sources. Of course, they're going to be looking at roster submission that goes to the DSS. That'll either be through NCFAS, and as the unit first gets going, it could still involve the paper rosters that have been submitted to the DSS, depending on when that provider, you know, transitioned into NCFAS. Also, they'll be looking at claims for the child and adult care food program. They'll be looking at arrival and departure times, which are the sign-in, sign-out records, as well as classroom attendance. Also, if there's transportation records or Smart Start tracking attendance, anything that, you know, where they're recording attendance. Errors that are found through these visits, errors in attendance recording, could result in a review of the child care provider agreement that is signed annually. Now it's signed in NCFAS. That goes back to part of that re-enrollment process I mentioned earlier. It could be just a refresher of what was signed and what they agreed to. or it could be that maybe some training is needed. Or if it rises to a certain level, it could be that a corrective action plan may need to be put in place with that provider. There'll also be determination of overpayments, if there were any overpayments due to the inconsistencies. And of course, if there is an overpayment, then there would be a voluntary payment agreement that would need to be signed through through the local purchasing agency. We are working on rule modifications currently to address repeated noncompliance. We're working with the Social Services Commission on that, and there will be parameters for determining noncompliance, corrective action plans, and determination of overpayments. Those parameters are still in development, so they're not completely finalized yet. And we do really expect that the work of this unit and some of these parameters will really evolve over the first year of their work, since this is a brand new unit for the division. The monitoring checklist that'll be completed by the consultant with the provider, it will be in DocuSign. And a copy will be emailed to the provider. So we're really excited about the ability to use DocuSign, and hopefully that'll be very convenient. As these visits are done, the providers and the local purchasing agencies will get a report from the facility visit and the attendance comparison. So everybody will be on the same page. And when a voluntary payment agreement is needed, that will be completed at the local purchasing agency at that level. So, of course, he would be involved with, because, of course, for many, that is the DSS. So, and a special note that she wanted me to communicate. So, when a provider in your county, again, has been monitored, like I said, you will receive the report. The report will include the findings and any corrective action plan that might have need to be put in place. And the corrections indicate any retroactive roster corrections to be completed in NCFAS based upon the attendance comparisons. The roster creations will create the overpayments, which will require action from the caseworker. And then the provider is assigned, would be assigned as the responsible party for that overpayment case. And that's where your voluntary payment agreement would come in for the collection of those overpayments. And if there are any providers that are no longer receiving subsidy, they stopped receiving subsidy for whatever reason, after a finding was found, then a manual process would be used for collecting any overpaid funds. So I know that was a lot of information, but it's a lot going on. So any questions about the new provider compliance unit?
There is a comment.
Okay.
There's a tremendous amount of fraud in the child care subsidy program. One way to address this is to require child support applications prior to the subsidy application. Too many providers are not accurately reporting attendance. Glad you are going to try to address some of this.
Great. Thank you. Yes, we... We don't know what kind of Pandora's box we might be opening, I'm glad we have that support. Thank you for that positive feedback.
Turn over the rocks and look, see what's there.
I know, right? Okay. Any other questions or comments?
Not on that one.
Okay.
There is another question, but not on that.
Okay, go ahead. Let's go ahead with this.
Has there been any conversation around how to handle 18 to 21 foster care children who need child care for their children who are not in foster care?
Yes, we have had some conversations around that. We don't have specific policy that says that those children are, from a state perspective, would be able to automatically receive child care services based on waiting lists. That is something that at the county level, you could incorporate into your local policy as far as your waiting list management. But there have been, in the past few weeks, there have been conversations that we are starting about this. So I don't know if there will be future changes. We're not quite at that point. But in the meantime, definitely at a local level in how you manage your waiting list with those local policies, that is one way you could prioritize that population.
So the county level, I mean, we have, you know, CPS, or we have, you know, other kinds of priorities on that list, all the way down to training or just, and so forth. So the county is free to do that right now.
Absolutely.
They just incorporate this as a specific group into their policy. That sounds like certainly on a short-term basis, the recommendation.
Absolutely. I would strongly encourage that if you feel like that is a population that needs that priority. And actually, speaking of waiting lists, that kind of made me think of something else. So we had asked for updated local policies to be submitted before the end of the year, and many of you have already submitted those, and I really appreciate that. After we asked for that, we kind of realized that we had not included the homelessness population as a required priority. That came about through the reauthorization of the final rules for the CCDF. So I am in the final stages of getting policy guidance issued, because in addition, so the feds tell us that we have to prioritize special needs, and now they're telling us that we have to prioritize homelessness. So for those who have submitted your updated local policies, they will need to be tweaked a little bit to include the homelessness population if it's not already included. So that's what's going on. I know some of you have come back and say, hey, I haven't gotten these approved. Did you receive them? We have received them. I've tried to respond to those. So that's what's going on with that. So look for that guidance to come out within the next week. And the very last thing that I wanted to talk about was just expenditures and spending. Not much of an update. The August expenditures were released this week. They are also available on our website. And I've had conversations with Janice recently, and we continue to urge all counties to be extremely cautious as you are looking at your spending and looking at potentially working your waiting list. If you go back to our allocation letter, you'll see that there was not much money available for actually working waiting lists. It was about $1.8 million statewide. So that's not a lot to pull a lot of children off of the waiting list. So just continue to exercise extreme caution around that. And also keep in mind that October 1st, we have the market rate increases. So there was $13 million that was available to account for those. So definitely, again, just continue to be cautious with that, with spending and pulling from the waiting list. And that's all I have this morning, unless there's any other questions or comments.
No other questions.
All right. Thank you so much for your time. I appreciate it.
Thank you, Elizabeth.
All right. Moving on to child welfare services. I'll start out by saying that we will have a visit here at our department tomorrow, actually, and Friday as well, from the Children's Bureau. And so we're looking forward to that conversation. We actually have a kind of a pre-meeting in the morning, I think at 9, with our staff and leadership in Child Welfare Department and the Children's Bureau to talk about some things happening in North Carolina, particularly the House Bill 630, you know, and things like that. And then our meeting will take place, and we do have invited our, I think it's our tri-chairs, or actually maybe four, from Children's Services Committee of the Directors Association. We've invited directors or designees from the 10 OSRI counties who are heavily involved in this. And again, I think looking forward to the conversation to kind of go through our program improvement plan, all the different goals and strategies and objectives and so on and so forth. Look at where we are. We've about to complete three quarters of the process. Time flies when you're having fun or something. And a lot of work has been done. Absolutely, a lot of work has been done. So we, you know, we may be looking, tweaking some things and get some feedback from them on that as well. So we'll share more of that after the meeting. The next item on the agenda is an update here to talk about Child Welfare Assist. And we have with us Paris Penny, who is our Senior Policy Advisor for the Department of Health and Human Services, and on a regular basis works very closely with our division and all of our programs. So, Paris?
Thank you, Wayne. Pleasure to be here. I appreciate the time this morning. I know you have a pretty packed agenda, so I'll be relatively quick in the update. At our presentation in May, we were pleased to announce the availability of the software application developed to provide you access to data related to possible risk indicators while working with children and families. Again, I want to reiterate, this application is another tool to assist you in making better and more informed decisions and the delivery of appropriate services for families and individuals. We're here today, as Wayne said, to provide you with an update about the timeline for the product, application, usage, activity, and some of our next steps that we'd like your support and help with. So just to kind of share a little bit of the data that we've been looking at, my understanding is there's about 3,800 child welfare staff across the state, and I personally want to thank you for the work that you do. It's very important, and I admire and respect the work that you do. I would like to see an uptick in the usage of the application. We are seeing a little bit of that, and we do expect it to double around the end of October, but the average daily login of 66 is relatively low compared to the number of staff we have across the state. A few counties have made Child Welfare Assist a part of their daily process, and Wayne and I will be reaching out to them to talk with them about how they've incorporated it into their daily process, and perhaps next quarter have some sort of report out from them or on their behalf. I want to reiterate, as always, safety is an important. It's part of safety for the child and the social worker. As a reminder, one of the unique features about this application is the approach with caution alert. So prior to this application, only law enforcement was aware of when to approach with caution because of a history of violent assault. So I just want to reiterate the importance that this application provides in allowing our workers to see when they should approach with caution. So this is on search activity. From what we understand, about 65% of calls are screened in for an assessment. Factoring in the numbers on average, about 40% of assessments are searched in Child Welfare Assist. So that's good considering it was rolled out early this year, and nice to see that. We will be looking going forward at the number of cases per county to the number of queries per county and report out next year. Again, we're going to do a lot of looking at our data and reporting this next quarter and hope to come back with more information. As always, the work you do is not 9 to 5. It is 24 hours a day, and we just wanted to reiterate that 11% of searches are done outside of business hours. So there is usage on weekends, midnight, 2 a.m. It's really important. We also wanted to highlight the darker blue from the screen will indicate the counties with more searches. So there are a few who are really using the application as a part of their daily process. And again, just another way to show the data of county usage. We see a real opportunity for about half the counties in the state to begin incorporating this. And then just as we move forward with the application, because we do want to make some improvements and enhancements, of course, we'd like to hear from those using the system for us to know where to put our energy and focus for enhancements. I always think it's very important for the users to provide us with the feedback on what works well, what you'd like to see improved. So again, if you want to contact Wayne or I, we'll certainly be reaching out to some of the counties to engage you in these discussions. And we do look forward to coming back next year with another update about the application. Okay, thank you. I know it was a packed agenda, so I don't want to take up much time.
One comment back. Thanks.
Thank you.
This is good. Yeah.
Well, thank you for the work you do.
And certainly, Paris, I want to get you the update and information. We will be looking at county by county data, as we always do.
Mm-hmm.
And again, I like your idea there of looking at those who seem to be utilizing it effectively. I'd like to hear from you, too.
Absolutely.
I want to reiterate what Perry said on that in terms of any issues, any lessons learned, probably some good stories in terms of, hey, this was really helpful here in the situation. And but maybe in a future webinar, we can have one of our counties share their practices.
That would be great. That would be great. Thank you.
Good. As always.
Thank you.
All right.
My pleasure.
Next up, another topic we've had a lot of conversation ongoing about, and that is our plan of safe care. And we're starting to get a little data. We're looking to get a little more data in, I think, on our activity in this regard with reports and screenings and referrals and that sort of thing. So with that in mind, I'm going to ask Jessica Geis-Albritton to share a little bit more information about Plan of Safe Care.
Thank you, Wayne. And good morning. I am going to keep pretty brief, but as Wayne said, I want to talk about the substance effect incident policy, and in particular, the portion that relates to the screening process that happens at intake. So what you see on the screen is our August data, and that is indicating to us that a very large portion of notifications resulted in screened-in reports. Understandably, there's a number of reasons why this could have happened, and it could very likely be the result of hospitals not yet implementing the notification procedures that are in line with the definitions of substance-affected infants. This also might mean that reports are being screened in for infants and families that do not need child welfare services. Here's the next slide. So the data is not going to tell us whether or not a notification was screened properly. That could only be done through a case review. So over the next quarter, CPRs will be covering the substance-affected infant policy as a hot topic, using collected county data as a starting point for their conversation with you. And should there be any concerning trends, there will be individual follow-up with the director. So additionally, starting in January 2018, the program monitoring tool will reflect the substance-affected infant policy requirements. So just as a quick reminder about the intake policy as it relates to substance-affected infants, the CAPTA legislation did not change any federal laws regarding child abuse or neglect. Additionally, no general statutes were changed to consider any type of prenatal abuse or neglect. So for that reason, every notification should not result in a screened-in report. The intake policy and the new maltreatment screening tool takes the infant's circumstances of exposure into consideration and is focused on the effect that the substance use is having on the individual infant. This policy is new. We only have a month of data, and obviously it's important to make an appropriate screening decision on every case. However, with this population, there could be some very serious unintended consequences should our community catch wind that every infant that meets these definitions is being screened in for a CPS investigation. For instance, CPS involvement may deter pregnant women from seeking prenatal care, delivery care, and drug treatment, and it could discourage pregnant women who do seek medical treatment from disclosing information about their drug use to healthcare providers. The existing literature supports the position that punitive approaches to substance use in pregnancy are ineffective and could have detrimental effects on both maternal and child health. So there's a very strong consensus from medical and public health communities that affirm that punitive approaches during pregnancy are ineffective and potentially harmful, and we certainly don't want to see the child welfare system be a part of a, or at least seem to be a part of a punitive approach. And finally, medication-assisted treatment is considered the gold standard in the treatment of pregnant women with opioid use disorders. And the abrupt continuation of opioids during pregnancy is not recommended and could result in harm to the baby as well as the mother, including death. So we, again, don't want to be inadvertently promoting women to do that. So that is it for now. Again, if there are any questions, please contact me, please contact your CPRs. And just as a reminder, the next email coming from Wayne to collect the data from the survey process will be going out on Monday. And that would be due within 10 business days. I believe that it's the 16th this month, but that'll be indicated in the email. In addition to the data that you put on the survey, the feedback that we've been getting about barriers and any other feedback about the policy and implementation has been really helpful. It has started a number of conversations internally, as well as between us and healthcare providers and individual hospitals even. So please keep that coming to us. It is really helpful and it is being heard. Thank you.
No questions. Awesome. Thank you.
Thank you, Jessica.
Thank you.
As Jessica said, I want to reiterate, getting one of these referrals is not in and of itself a screen-in, and it's critically important, as we do with all reports that come in, that we go through the screening process on these. And as Jessica stated there on the slide, you know, we don't want the word to get out that just because you're referred by the hospital, that's just automatically going to be investigated by DSS and have a detrimental effect on healthcare of women and children. So we'll look at some data. We'll get some more data, I think, next month, and then we're going to probably have some conversations. This is probably another topic that we'll continue to talk about. I think it's important. There's a lot of parts to it, you know, connecting with other agencies and programs, disciplines. There is actually, I think we've got a few folks from our department going down to Atlanta, I think it's early November, for a meeting with the Children's Bureau. And we and other states are talking about our experience in implementing Plan of Safe Care. From what we hear, I think other states are challenged by this requirement and seeking the better ways of doing business. And so we hope we'll get some feedback and learn from each other when we send a multidisciplinary group of folks down there from public health, DSS, mental health, and so forth. So we'll be getting some feedback on that. Okay, in terms of child welfare, the only other things I want to mention, just a couple of things. Number one, Dear County Director letters. There were a few that went out September 1. There was actually one on September the 6th. From child welfare, and this is, we're trying to get the data cleaned up, all right? And this one is relating to correcting data in the legacy data systems, open 5094s, individuals 21 plus. I think some of those may have been really older ones that may actually have not shown being closed, but maybe were. So we may not have had as many as we had thought, but it's important going forward. And the other thing I think went out was about coding appropriately for children 18 to 20. 18 to 30, used to be if you were 18, we knew you weren't foster care unless you had the agreement, the CARS agreement. But now we do have foster care expanded through age 20. So I think some of the data, we want to get that cleaned up. So it's going to be something to pay attention to. There was a September 1 Dear County Director letter in REAP. This is involving, I'm sure you've taken a look at, involving a court of appeals decision made earlier around jurisdiction. And so I think to some extent the finding there may contradict certain policy and present challenges to our temporary parental safety agreement situations as well. We are continuing to work on this. We will anticipate having a topic for a webinar. We're going to try to do this in October, and we'll have our Attorney General's office representatives here to present on the implications of this. I think there is Mecklenburg, as it states in the Dear County Director letter, has filed a petition for discretionary review. So anyway, we're not changing our policy until this gets resolved. But the impact of NREAP is over the requirement of filing the petition in the county where the child is found. In certain conflict situations, this could pose an issue. And as a matter of fact, we had some conversation on Friday with the county leadership, and in terms of the implications of this. So this is one of those that is kind of in the works right now, but we're going to be getting some more information and more detail. Certainly, if you got any questions, as it states here, work with your county attorney, contact your children's program representative. You can feel free contacting me if something bubbles up that's sort of an urgent situation, as happened last week, and we anticipate that may happen. Another one dealt with the resource parent curriculum, staff facilitator opportunity, new child welfare training resources. I think those are the key ones. We may have some other letters coming out next week. I think it's October 2 on Monday, so we'll be letting you know about that. The other thing I wanted to also briefly mention in our child welfare is we've been having some work being done looking at our child fatality review process. And what I'm going to talk about today is what we call our full review, the full review process. And kind of where we are, as I think we've talked about before, is we've got, you know, we've been short staffed with one full-time, one temporary position for many years, and we have gotten behind. And so we're trying to figure out how to get current. We really want to be able to do the full reviews and child fatality reviews within 3 to 6 months of the fatality. And that 3 to 6 months will be dependent upon different factors, including all the information and data being available and so forth. And obviously, it also means not until the DA hold, if there is one, goes off. So all those are factors that influence that. But ideally, all things considered, if we're able, we'd like to have a sort of a timeline and certainly not be 2 years behind or wherever we are now. But what we're looking at doing here is effective October 1, we're looking at scheduling for reviews, those fatalities taking place from July 1, 2016 forward in chronological order, I guess you would say. And so moving forward, that's what we want to try to do to get caught up. Now, where we'd like to be is by perhaps July of 2018 in a position where we're really current doing them within the prescribed timeline in working with our counties and our child protection team folks as well. But in the meantime, we've identified there's those that would occur prior to July 1, 2016, the older ones, and we're looking to develop a process to do what would be sort of a record review. And we're looking at a methodology for doing that. It would probably be, you know, just one of our program staff to be determined coming out to just review the case record. It would not be a community review, it would not be a full review, but it would be just pretty much looking at policy, adherence to policy in terms of the case. So there's a lot more details than that I won't discuss right now, but what we're probably looking to do is communicate. We ran this through the Community Child Protection Team Advisory Committee, State Advisory Committee last week, to get their feedback as well. So what we're kind of looking at doing here, I think, is sending a letter soon to come to the county DSS director, to come to the Community Child Protection Team chairperson in your county, where we're going to be saying this, it's describing our plan. But also what we're going to say is that for those older fatalities that have been screened in for review, that we would be proposing to do a record review, for lack of a better term right now. And but we're going to invite the DSS director and the community child team chair to engage your community child protection team in making a determination as to whether you would like to recommend to us that there, for one of those older ones, that there be a full review, and we will try to accommodate your request. So we would probably give you 30 days to, you know, be able to discuss at the next meeting of your community child protection team in order to respond to us, and then we would plan from there. So I did want to let you know about that, which is taking place. Any questions?
No questions.
All right, we are moving on to NC Fast, and I'll turn it over. I think on the phone we have Angela Taylor and her team.
Hi, this is Angela. So just to give everybody, we've got a long slide deck, so we are not going to go through every slide. So Andy will let you know when to advance. And so I encourage others to go and look through the details here, but we're going to hit the highlights so that we don't spend an hour and a half trying to go through our slide deck here. So with that, I'm going to hand it over to David Jovacchini to start out with our Project 3 update.
Thanks, Angie. Good morning, everybody. Just a few quick updates on childcare. Elizabeth actually hit a good number of the items I was already planning to cover, so I'll just sort of go through this quickly. We are in with our pilot groups A, B, and C, and roster submission for August services obviously took place early September, and we issued about $20 million for the August service month. That is on top of the roughly $26 million that have been spent through NCFAST going back to pilot from last spring. So we're just shy of about $50 million in the child care program being issued out of NCFAST at this point as we prepare for the roster submission for the service month of September. Everybody should be aware that NCFAST, the provider portal piece of that is now up during the week until 9 p.m. So we have had requests from providers to extend the availability of the provider portal. And so on weeknights, it should be available until 9, and that means during this next roster submission cycle, the 5th is a Thursday, so they should have until 9 p.m. on Thursday, October 5th, to submit their roster. Everyone should be aware about the schedule change for Group D, so we are currently targeting the first couple of days in November for Group D case activation. I think tentatively planning to try to do it on November 4th right now so we can have the most amount of time left in the month of November to deal with any follow-up items based upon the case activation run that we need to do. We did do a test run in our staging environment of Group D, and 95% of the Group D cases activated. That resulted in about 600 or so that didn't activate, and there should be information and reports coming out to the Group D counties about those cases and what you can do now to clean those up and hopefully get more of them, more of that last 5% to activate when we actually get to November. So please, if you're in Group D, have your staff looking for that information, as well as look at the fund ranking that you've got in NCFAST and configure any Smart Start enhancements if you're actually going to pay them for the November service month. These are a few things that I think some counties may not have looked at closely at when we activated cases and have had some questions after the fact. So we just want to make sure that for anybody that's left in Group D, if you're having Smart Start enhancements that you want to pay during the month of November, please make sure that you've got those configured to start November 1st. And then obviously take a look at your fund rankings as well. And reach out to the NCFAST team if your staff have any questions on how to do either of those functions. Go ahead to the next slide, Andy. Just a couple of quick reminders for the providers. Each month we still see a handful of providers that submit all the attendance for every child that they're caring for, but they forget to submit the entire roster. There's one final step that they have to do each month. So as you talk with your providers, please remind them to do that. NCFAST does call those providers after the fact and give them a reminder that they need to do it, but we still see a good number of providers that don't do that every month that we're trying to get accustomed to hitting that final button. One other point of clarification, we also get a number of questions or inquiries about payments not being deposited into a provider's account on the 15th, and I just want to be very clear that the payment is actually expected between the 15th and the 20th, and in NCFAST it'll actually show issued, but that doesn't actually mean that it has cleared through the provider's bank processing yet, so they may not actually see that in their bank account. So at the highest level, it could take up until the 20th for them to receive payment, so please try not to set expectations that they should be receiving it on the 15th. It may come on the 15th, but it may also take a couple days beyond that. There's a few other things that I wanted to make everybody aware. With the October payment, we are looking to make the transition from deposits by child to the one lump sum amount that they should be receiving for the September services with the October payment. That has been something and we've been working on with FIS, and I know a number of the providers that have been receiving the payments for the last little while from NCFAST that have a significant number of children have been asking for this. So that should be something that is a welcome change for them in October. And then the last reminder is that counties should still send manual action notices, with the exception of the research packets, or if a child is pulled off the waiting list, we'll send those automatically. We are working with one of our pilots to do some final validation on notices. We're also removing any incorrect notices that are sent to the provider portal automatically each night. But we are getting closer to actually turning on the automated notices and are looking to do that soon. But in the meantime, just a reminder that the manual notices should be sent until that point in time.
David, the question came through. Is there any way to know how much of that $20 million was issued correctly? Local reports are that some providers are receiving too much reimbursement and others too little.
So at the highest level, you know, we think that number is accurate. At the case level, there may be some situations where we would need to look and see what exactly happened. There's been I'll give just a couple examples of some things that we're seeing and looking at right now. So one example where a provider might report that they got paid a little bit more than they were expecting is if they have over 55 hours entered in the plan of care, then we will actually pay at 150%, which is rare, but we have seen a good number of instances where the case in NC Fast, the attendance in the plan of care has been set up for 12 hours a day, 5 days a week, and so you do the math and that gets to 60 hours and thus we'll pay at 150%, when really what should be entered on the plan of care is probably a schedule varies between 32 and 55, and we would then pay at 100% of the level of care. So we're seeing a couple of instances like that where we can correct that information and then get the payments to be correct, that have in some instances paid the provider a little bit too much. And then we've seen the flip side where sometimes the information has resulted in 75% being paid when it should be 100%. But the system, and I looked through a handful of these with my team yesterday, does appear to be doing that math correctly. For so far, every example we have seen. There are a few other situations that are provider specific that we are looking into, and this is in relation to some of the information that we're dealing with when it comes to the license status and the information from regulatory, where we are seeing some challenges processing location and ownership changes and then reports of a provider getting paid at the wrong star rating. So those are some other impacts that could be out there that we're looking at sort of on a provider by provider basis. So I hope that sort of clarifies a couple of the items that we're seeing when payment is not exactly correct or what it's supposed to be or what the provider might be expecting. We've also seen a couple instances where the provider was expecting an enhancement and that enhancement wasn't actually set up in NC Fast. So obviously they didn't get that additional fund or those additional funds. And we've also been answering a good number of questions, well, maybe less so now that we're back into the school year, but we were answering a good number of questions related to blended rate and how that was going to be impacted because during the summer, they were receiving blended rate, which is 83% versus the 100% level of care that they were used to receiving in the past. So all this to basically say there's a variety of things that I think are still getting clarified, both for counties and for providers to understand maybe why they're getting paid something that they weren't expecting at this point in time. But at the highest level, I think we're fairly confident that what we've been paying when the case is entered correctly is accurate.
Okay. One more that just came in. Are counties seeing any reduction in workload due to P3?
So at this point in time, you know, it's a little bit tricky to answer that, one, because we don't have the pilot counties on the phone that have been, you know, kind of going through this for the longest period of time. There's always going to be a bit of a spike when we first go live with the program in terms of demand on staff and sort of resources. So I think over time, what we'll start to see is that the system stabilizes and folks are more comfortable with the child care functionality and sort of ongoing processing, that we might start to see some of that. But I I don't have any quantifiable information at this point in time to say that staff have been impacted actually one way or another in terms of needing, you know, sort of less time in the day or more time in the day than what they needed before.
Sure. One more, should a provider enter a roster with all the children, even if the child is in a different county?
So that question, the answer to that is probably yes. And if they have questions, they should, you know, definitely reach out to the provider help desk to confirm. But in general, the way the roster works, I'll just give an example. If I'm a provider in Wake County and I take care of, I care for 19 children that come from Wake and one child that comes from Durham, I will actually do attendance for all 20 of those children in the provider portal and get paid for all 20 via direct deposit. So the funding for the Durham child will actually come out of the Durham County allocation, and the 19 will come out of the Wake County allocation, but the provider will do attendance for all 20 at the same time in the same roster in the portal.
Great. Thank you.
Okay. Yes. And then I think, Andy, I might have one or two more quick slides that I will sort of skim over. So this is the information about re-enrollment. So the one thing I would call your attention to is that we do have a report in FastHelp that shows the status of the provider's contract and whether or not they have completed re-enrollment. If they have completed re-enrollment, then they should have a contract that is good through the end of next year, so it should end in 2018. And then the last bullet I want to draw your attention to, they, in theory, have until the end of the calendar year to do re-enrollment, but we really want them to try to have this done before Thanksgiving or at least the end of November. The reason being is that in the month of December, if that provider is not going to re-enroll, we'll actually have to take actions to start having the conversations with the family about, do you want to stay at this facility and start paying the full private rate, or do you want to move to another provider that's going to be continuing to participate in the subsidy program, as well as the fact that we need to provide adequate notice for when that action might take place, and that would need to actually happen probably around the 12th or 13th of December based upon allowing 10 business days. So as much effort as can be given to the re-enrollment communications and have your staff check the status of your providers to have them re-enroll sooner rather than later, that would be fantastic, because we really don't want to have to work through any, if at all, sort of relocating children from one provider to another come the holiday time frame. All right, go ahead to the next slide, Andy. Okay, so Tanya asked me to cover a little bit related to Project 3, and in keeping with the theme of trying to go a little bit at a higher level, you guys will have all the details from these slides, but she wanted me to call out the energy boot camp for supervisors that are being conducted and making sure that everybody that's aware of those activities going on, if your staff need to participate in some of those energy training. And then obviously more information will start to come out as we get closer to the December timeframe for when the LEAP season will start again. On the next slide, Andy, you'll actually see, I think, the dollars associated with energy. So we've obligated just shy of $8 million. This is for this fiscal year, so it's not going back to the few months we had for the pilot counties did caught the tail end of LEAP and did SIP last fiscal year, but roughly $8 million obligated for energy assistance since the new fiscal year began. And I think that probably wraps us up on the P3 items, and I think Dennis is going to cover P4.
Yeah. Hello, everyone. This is Dennis Ellis, project manager for P4. So first slide here shows our high-level project timeline. So it shows that we're still into the pilot phase for release one, getting close to approaching moving into the group one counties, and I'll get into some details with that later on. And then at a high level, our next major release is release two at the end of December, release three in July of next year. Moving on to the next slide, slide eight.
So our pilot counties did go into production the beginning of August. We had another minor release of enhancements middle of September. Conversion has been ongoing with central registry and pulling foster care data into the system for the pilot counties. There will be iterative conversion runs as we bring in each subsequent group of counties. And one note here at the bottom of the slide deck regarding the mobile app. So the development of the mobile app is complete, and we're wrapping up our internal testing. Our target release that had been planned for late September is going to push into October. We've run into some roadblocks with getting the infrastructure in place for the production environment for mobile, and also we're working through some details about the mobile device management software that needs to be in place for the counties that, as they begin to use that. So that's going to push us into the beginning of October, but we're looking forward to that rollout with pilot counties of the mobile app then. Moving on to slide 9, this is our rollout schedule. So this hasn't changed any as to the counties that we're showing here that are our pilots and our group one counties, and then you see the kind of geographical rollout of the subsequent groups. We are starting to engage the group 2 through 5 counties in doing the planning workshops for the leadership teams there to help them get ready. And so you can refer to this map as to the high level groupings of those counties and their general timelines. And then we've got more details in some of the subsequent slides. Moving on to slide 10. So this is kind of some details regarding our pilot county activities right now. So as the pilot counties have been using the system, they have identified items that they feel like are necessary to be resolved. Some are defects, some are enhancements. So we're working through the details of those with the pilot counties now. We've got a very specific list of those, and we've got target delivery dates for each one of them. And so we're just kind of working through the details of those with the pilot counties now. That'll be key to getting the endorsement from the pilot counties for the actual moving into group one. We're still tentatively showing that as an October 23rd date, but we've got to make some more progress in working through this issue list with the pilot counties to get that date confirmed. The next slide, 11, is just a high-level view of our help desk tickets as they've come in over the past couple of months. You can see an average of 5 help desk tickets per day, and this is across all of the 5 pilot counties. And you see some spikes there at the end of August, and then the second week in September, that was when we had conversion of the foster care cases that didn't occur with the initial deployment, but they occurred later on when we got into the timing of converting those foster care cases to get ready for the foster care reimbursement payments. Then on slide 12, lessons learned from the pilot counties. This is really the key benefit that comes out of our pilot counties, and they've really done a tremendous job in their use of the system and learning how to use it and giving us feedback that will then help all the subsequent county deployments. And the highlight of that really is the idea of training beginning early on so that the users can be familiar with the system before their go live. And this is something really the key to learning from the pilot counties was to start that training activity even earlier than we had anticipated. So we're now recommending really a 3-month head start on training for each group of counties. We've got the training materials in place on the Learning Gateway. We've got the sandbox server environment in place now. And I know the group one counties are already well underway in their training activities. And we'll be focusing on that in the leadership workshops that we have for each of the subsequent groups to get them set up with user accounts in the sandbox and get them access to the Learning Gateway so that each group of counties can focus on that training ahead of time.
We have 2 questions that came in that are just about the same. Does the commitment still exist that no additional rollouts will occur without pilot county approval? And will all the showstoppers be resolved prior to rolling out, not workarounds, but real permanent fixes?
So this is Angela. We're working with the pilot counties to identify what is, you know, deemed showstopper for, you know, our group ones and then the rollout. So there may be some things that we identify that in working with the group one counties. If you remember, group one counties were actually our JAD counties that actually assisted us with the requirements and also assisted us with some enhancements that they had identified. So we're working with the pilot counties as well as our group one counties to make sure that we identify what are those items that we feel they want to have in place before the group one goes. And then we're targeting the things that have been identified by the pilot counties before statewide rollout. But some of these things include enhancements, and some of those enhancements are changing out of the box. So those are some things that we're negotiating and working with both the pilot counties and the state to make sure that we have definitive dates of when those will be able to be there and the things that we feel that are, you know, working with the pilot counties that are pertinent, we have to have day one. So the answer is yes. They do get that go decision, but I think there's some negotiations because there's one or two enhancements that we know will have to be in a current release, and those are twice a year. So those are some of the things that we're working with the counties to make sure that we identify, you know, some of the key things and target dates to have those in. And I believe right now one of them we're still working on with IBM and with the pilot counties, and one of the other ones I believe right now is still slated for around March timeframe. So as you look at our schedule, we have to look at, you know, what is the impact and working with the pilot county so that, you know, they are communicating back to everyone, you know, where we are and what is if there is a workaround, is it feasible, does it impact, and what is the impact? So I think all of those things are being discussed, and that will also go, I think we have some conversations with both pilot and group one counties and executive level management here at the department this week. So hopefully we'll all be on the, have something to share with you all in the next 2 weeks of definitive things and what those go, no-go decisions are and those enhancements that we're trying to target and the time frame for those. So be looking in the next 2 weeks for some things coming out from the project as well as from our pilot counties.
And another one that just came in, why can't all the counties access training now?
The training content is out there, but one of the things that we learned from the pilot rollout was that if we allow everyone to go in and kind of self-select their training courses that they want to participate in, then when we start to do reporting on that to show progress towards completing the training, then it kind of skews that data because people might go out there and self-register themselves for maybe every training material out there just out of their general interest. But then that would then skew our reporting of progress towards completing the training. So what we've done is we've set up a registration key process where we just basically assign a security key to a given county so that then there is some control by the directors and the county champions as to which of their staff are assigned to which training materials. So we still are committed to, you know, so the training content is ready. We will get that into each of the county's hands as soon as possible, but it does need to be done in that kind of controlled fashion so that then when we get ready to do the reporting of progress towards completing the training, we can have an accurate picture of that.
And I think a lot of this is being shared at the leadership work groups and when they would be scheduled to get into the sandbox in the learning management gateway.
Just one comment that just came in. Let's slow down the P4 train in order to get this right. So just a comment.
Okay. On slide 13, we've got some details on the upcoming P4 activities. The Western Leadership Workshops are underway now, going on through September and October. The sandbox is available now for all the Group 1 counties, and they're in the process of getting their users signed up for that and getting access to that. Like I mentioned earlier, the web-based training is all out there. on the Learning Gateway. We have had a number of updates in the content of training based on feedback that came from the pilot counties. And then there's a mention here of that course registration key that I was just discussing. The next slide, slide 14, just provides a geographical map of the schedule for the leadership workshops. So some of those have already been completed, some are ongoing as we speak, and you can see the dates on those. Those continue out through October and somewhat into November. But these, I think we've found have been really beneficial to each of the counties as we get into these. That will help in a couple of day session, each of the counties understand in detail what they need to do to be prepared.
Just a question about the training that just came back in again. Counties have an estimated time to train in each section for staff? Can we also have an estimated time to complete all the training? This will help with the planning.
Yes, we can certainly get you that. I'm not sure that I've got a good number off the top of my head as to what that would be. It's obviously somewhat kind of user dependent based on their level of experience. But we can get you an estimate on that. We'll take that as a to-do.
Thanks.
All right. So is that it for P4?
Yes. Unless there are any other questions.
No other questions.
Thank you.
So Andy, I'm going to skip you all the way down to slide number 16. And so I will go real quickly and finish up here as I promised. Just trying to give you some quick updates for P9, which is our Medicaid self-service. We've been implementing several small components. Again, we're really targeting our secure inbox as it relates to Medicaid. And so as you can see, in the August release, we implemented the ability for citizens to actually receive those notices listed here in the secure inbox. We're also working with CMS currently now trying to get remote identity proofing in place, which will allow a second layer of identity proofing for those citizens that are using the secure inbox, so working on that. We also got all of our 1095Bs corrected through the IRS in August, and continuing, we've got some changes coming now from IRS for the next year's 1095B that we'll be working on. As you can see, we also, in the September release at the bottom of slide 16, we did some state level QC redesign, and we also are working to get the 4E foster care, 4E adoption, and special needs adoption moved from the P26 into P7. So moving on to slide number 17, we'll continue to look at the MEC check, which went in as well. So what that means is now that when we get transfers from ACF, the MEC check today, we have about 17,000 applications that come through the FFM that are already on Medicaid. And so currently staff has to go through, look at that, they identify it's on Medicaid, put the right codes in. We have put some automation in so that we do that MEC check internally, the NCFAS, so staff don't have to touch around those 17,000 applications coming from FFM. So we will do that automatically. We will identify that they're already on Medicaid receiving the same, and we'll send that directly back up to the FFM. So that is taking some of that workload for those 17,000 off of your staff. Also, in October and November, some things that we're trying to hit is looking at some additional changes on the report card. Also, we've got our COLA-UNCOLA automation project that's underway to get some of that automated. And then we also have 8110 Part 3 coming in. And then no-touch research Phase 1, we're looking at that. In addition to some of the key things going on with P9 is we're also working with the department on Medicaid transformation. And so a lot of staff will start getting engaged in that, and we'll be looking at the priorities for the Medicaid self-service so that we realign with what's going on with Medicaid transformation. So moving on down to slide number 18, this is another part of P9 is our program integrity. So currently, The project is underway with getting all of the requirements identified, reviewing through those with the stakeholders to gain agreement. We've engaged two program integrity workers at the state level, and we also have worked to get requirements and engagement with Alamance, Skilford, and Pitt, who have been working with us hand in hand. We appreciate their participation. So our target is to have as the requirements phase was completed in August, and we're starting now into our planning and development phase, which is will started in the beginning of September and will continue throughout the next few months as we start to roll out. Moving on down to slide number 19, this is Project 11, which is our new Medicare card replacement, and this is where we are now replacing, our federal partners are replacing the Social Security number that's on the Medicare card with a unique number. So that is our project here at NCFAS to make those accommodating changes for the new numbers to go on there, which is the health insurance claim number that we'll now be tracking. So our plan for that is that we will be pushing all of our data and updates to CMS and our downstream partners, which is also TRAX, on February of 2018, and then we'll finish up everything. CMS will start issuing those cards out to recipients on April of 2018. So our scheduled plan is to have everything tested and in production by February in preparation for that April 2018. Moving on down to slide number 20, this is our document management project, which we are kicked off August 16th. We're in our discovery phase process. As you can see, we have some counties there that are represented. We also have a work group that we're working through as part of the EAS, which is our document repository work group. These numbers have changed already. I think we're up to 202 people that have been registered now, so continuing to get more participation in the sessions. And our plan is to come to the Social Services Institute in October to kind of give a review of what it's going to look like. So hopefully we'll have everything in place, working with our state DIT to get all the contracts and the environment set up before that October timeframe. So that is a quick and real fast P9, P11, and P12 update. So I'll take any questions.
There was a question, a Medicaid question. Our rep is telling us we need to upload into NCFAS for PERM next year. Can you tell us more about this?
So what that is that for PERM, we have a new requirement from our federal partner, CMS, that no longer will we have state program integrity folks doing the PERM. It will be federal folks. So what we're doing is we'll be working with DMA as well as the counties, and we're trying to target to have everything in place so that when they come in for that review, whenever that is, that we have to be ready by June 30th of 2018. So we will have everything ready for our federal partners now to start doing the PERM requirements and review. So that is the plan. And so what we'll have in place is depending on if you've got your own document management, what you need to do, if you are converting into NCFAS, what you need to do for that. And anyone that doesn't have a document management, how you would actually get that in. So that's all part of the document management Project 12. So you'll be getting some more clarifications in the next several months.
Okay. Did have another question that just popped in. Back to child care. Are there any funding reports for supervisors and directors in NCFAS as there are for energy and other programs? These would be very really helpful.
This is David. Yes, there are a good number of reports available on the child care expenditures. You should be able to see most of the same information that you are accustomed to in the past. So you'd be able to see your spending, your coefficients, and things of that nature. I don't have the list in front of me at the moment, but what I will do is take that back to see if that's something that we can add into our weekly message that should come out hopefully on Friday to just clarify where some of those more financially focused reports are available.
Thanks. No more questions.
All right. Thank you, Andy.
All right. I think we have concluded everything on the agenda for today. The only one quick thing I wanted to add is certainly we're thinking about our folks down east. I know that on the Outer Banks and some areas on the very eastern part of North Carolina, we're seeing some gusty winds and maybe even tropical storm winds out on the Outer Banks and things like that. And I just want to, I know I had a conversation with a couple of directors a couple of weeks ago, subsequent to Hurricane Irma coming through. We are aware that some counties may have children in your custody placed, perhaps through Interstate Compact or perhaps in facilities, treatment facilities down in Florida or Georgia or those areas impacted. And so anyway, if in regard to Irma, those children you may have in Florida, if you have those children that were displaced, either through their family or through facility, I'd like to know that. This is something that Children's Bureau would like for us to report. And if by chance there's any such displacement of children in DSS custody in the eastern part of North Carolina, I think probably Maria is going to take a hard right, hopefully, and get on out of your way. And but if there is anything, and most likely not, but there is, please let me know about that.
The last thing that that came in through emergency management was that it was like in a really hard right.
So it's going to probably this.
But right now it's just right off the coast as a tropical storm.
Mm-hmm. Stirring up things down there. So I think that's all we have.
Questions? Couple
yes.
of comments. Once the reorganization at DHHS is complete, could local directors get a current org chart
yep.
of the department and various divisions? Then a second one, when the state releases their org chart, it would be helpful if they could also share contact information and a short description of their roles and responsibilities. If they could keep the information updated and easily available.
I think those are good recommendations. And so basically what I'm hearing is we want DHHS and its divisions, particularly those divisions for whom county DSS or their staff, directors and staff, would need to have contact. And the other thing I'm hearing is a little bit about their role would probably be beneficial to all of us because...
Yeah, we don't like to know that.
Right. Yeah, we probably need it too. So that you know who to call the first time because it's an efficiency thing because you aren't calling all over the place. And then we aren't having to transfer calls all over the place. So... roles and responsibilities. We're going to work on this. This is a good thing for us too. And keep it updated. Okay.
And one more comment. Just wanted to comment on the OST process. We appreciate the changes being made to provide more support to the counties and improving communications.
It's a challenge, and but we believe very strongly that we have to connect the dots. The program, the OST program consultants and the technology. And, you know, we've had some conversations. So we're working on this. I know Regina's working with David Locklear and certainly Barbara is working with Carol McClanahan. The team will still be a team in a sense because there are some things we want to share with each of them, with each group, in terms of maintaining some knowledge about other programs. And so we'll continue to do that. Okay. We will conclude our call today and want to thank everybody and have a great rest of the week.